Good morning, and welcome to the French Protestant Huguenot Church. You bless God with your presence here today, and you bless each other with your presence here today. I hope that this time of worship is what you need, not only for this day, for this moment, but for where you are, wherever that might be, on your faith journey. We are happy to have you. If you are a long-time member or a first-time visitor or a tourist just passing through, if you would, if you are visiting with us, in your pew box there is a little book. If you'll please open it up and put your information in there. We just want to know who you are and where you have come from. And if there are ways that we can minister to you in the coming days, please let us know and we'd be happy to reach out to you and do that. But this is not one of those where someone's going to come knocking on your door and say, come back to church next week. But we do hope that you enjoy what is here today. But more importantly, I hope that you give God your best today. The flowers on our altar table this morning are given by the Thomases, to the glory of God, for Reverend Claude Philippe de Richebourg and Anne Chastain. Beautiful flowers for a former pastor of this church. Immediately following worship today, we'll have two wonderful opportunities. If you'd like a tour of the church, please meet down here in front of the altar table. A member of our congregation will tell you all about this building and about Huguenot heritage. And then also at 44 Queen, right down Queen Street, we will gather for collation, a time of refreshments and fellowship of food and beverage. So please stick around after worship and join us and continue in the gathering that is this Sunday morning. It might not be a beautiful day outside, but it is good to be in this warm, safe place to worship God together. So let us do worship God together on this day. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Worship continues on page 3 of our liturgies. Let us pray. O Almighty God and Heavenly Father, we have come together for the public sanctification of this Lord's Day to offer unto Thee our praises and our prayers and to hear Thy holy word. Thou hast promised to hearken favorably unto all those who call upon Thee in the name of Thy Son. We therefore beseech Thee to look down upon us in mercy and to purify our thoughts and affections, that we may render unto Thee an acceptable service. Great God, we humble ourselves before Thee. We adore Thy majesty, we extol Thy wisdom, Thy power, and Thy goodness, which appear with such brightness in the marvelous works of creation and redemption. We acknowledge Thy tender love in the manifold favors, spiritual and temporal, which we continually receive at Thy hand. But we praise Thee more especially with all Christians who are assembled this day, that Thou didst send Thy Son into the world to save us, and that He rose from the dead for our justification. We bless Thee that Thou hast given us, by His glorious resurrection, so lively a hope of everlasting life. O God, Thy glory is great in all Thy churches, and the praise of Thy name is heard in all the assemblies of Thy saints. May our thanksgivings ascend unto Thy throne. Make us worthy to be partakers of the resurrection of the just, and of the glory of the kingdom of heaven, whither Jesus Christ hath entered as our forerunner, where He liveth and reigneth, where He is adored and glorified, with Thee and the Holy Ghost, God blessed forever. Amen. Will you please stand as we sing together hymn number 45.
Joy, 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 joy
Our worship continues on page 5 of our liturgies. Hear with reverence the Ten Commandments of the Law of God as they are written in the 20th chapter of the book of Exodus. God spake all these words, saying, I am the Lord thy God, who brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image, or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them. For I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children, unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto the thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless that taketh his name in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. Honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house, nor anything that is thy neighbor's. Hear also what our Lord Jesus Christ saith in the 22nd chapter of the Gospel according to St. Matthew. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Dearly beloved, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Please be seated. Let us therefore humbly confess our sins. O Lord God, eternal and almighty Father, we confess before thy divine majesty that we are miserable sinners, born in corruption and iniquity, prone to evil, and of ourselves incapable of any good. We acknowledge that we transgress in various ways thy holy commandments, so that we draw down on ourselves, through thy righteous judgment, condemnation, and death. We are, O Lord, under heartfelt sorrow for having offended thee, and we implore thy grace to relieve our wretchedness. Vouchsafe, O most gracious God and merciful Father, to have compassion on us, in the name of thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Pardon our sins, give us the graces of the Holy Spirit, and increase them day by day, to the end that, heartily acknowledging our unworthiness and forsaking our sins, we may be filled with that godly sorrow which worketh repentance unto salvation, and may bring forth fruits of righteousness acceptable to thee. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Testament lesson is from the book of Psalms. It is Psalm 149. Praise the Lord. Sing to the Lord a new song, his praise in the assembly of the faithful. Let Israel be glad in its maker. Let the children of Zion rejoice in their king. Let them praise his name with dancing, making melody to him with tambourine and lyre. For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He adorns the humble with victory. Let the faithful exult in glory. Let them sing for joy on their couches. Let the high praises of God be in their throats and two-edged swords in their hands, to execute vengeance on the nations and punishment on the peoples, to bind their kings with fetters and their nobles with chains of iron, to execute on them the judgment decreed. This is the glory for all the faithful ones. Praise the Lord. Testament lesson comes from the Gospel of Luke, verses 27 through 31. But I say to you that listen, love your enemies, do good to those that hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who abuse you. If anyone strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also. And from anyone who takes away your coat, do not withhold even your shirt. Give to everyone who begs from you. And if anyone takes away your goods, do not ask for them again. Do to others as you would have them do to you. Here ends the reading.
Let thy mercy shine upon us. O God, make clean our hearts within us. O Lord God, we render thanks unto thee that thou hast called us to the knowledge and profession of the Christian faith. We beseech thee to preserve and increase it in us, to the end that continuing steadfast in the same, we may sincerely unite in the confession of the Church universal. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived of the Holy Ghost and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate. He was crucified. He died. He was buried. He went into the place of departed spirits. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven. He sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty, and thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost. I believe the Holy Church Universal, the communion of saints, the remission of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Lord our God, Creator and Father of the human race, who has commanded that prayer and supplication be made for all humankind, we offer unto thee our intercessions for the peace of the world and for the happiness and salvation of all people. Deliver, we beseech thee, O Lord, from spiritual blindness all the nations that still sit in darkness. Thou didst so love the world that thou gavest thine only Son to die as a propitiation, not only for our sins, but also for the sins of the whole world. Thou hast taught us that he came to be a light unto the Gentiles and to bring salvation unto the ends of the earth, and that there is none other name under heaven given among men and women whereby we may be saved. Grant, O Almighty God and merciful Father, that all your people may be gathered unto the name of our Lord, to the end may know and adore thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. O God of mercy, have pity on all those who are suffering by war, pestilence, or any other scourge, and on all who are in affliction. We commend to thy care the widow and the orphan, the poor and the stranger, all who are in peril by land or by water or by air, all who endure persecution for the gospel, all who are distressed in mind, the infirm, the sick, and the dying. Comfort and relieve them according to their several necessities, and give them a happy issue out of their trials and afflictions. And God, we ask that you hear our silent prayers as we lift them up to you. Favorably hear us, O God. Graciously hear all who have at this time offered up their prayers unto thee. Reject not the supplications of thy servants, but grant us the blessings we have asked of thee and all others which are necessary for us, through Jesus Christ our Lord, in whose name we offer up our prayers. Amen. Our hymn is number 205. Will you please stand as we sing together?
Thank you.
one of the wonderful jobs as part of my calling here as a minister is I get to do a lot of weddings here at the church. We had a glorious wedding last night of Hampton and Rebecca. They were the oddballs because they're local. Most of the weddings that I do are from people from off. They travel for whatever reason to this city, to this place, and to this sanctuary specifically because they love it. They want to get married here. Fortunately, I have a chance to talk to these couples beforehand, and I ask them all the good questions, you know, how did you meet, how did you get engaged, all that kind of stuff. And then they asked me, said, now Woody, do you like offer premarital counseling? Because we want to make sure that we do this thing right. And I look at them and I say, well, I'm glad you want to do it right because that's very important. But no, I don't offer any premarital counseling. No, I don't offer that at all. And they look at me like I'm a little crazy. And I say, no, you need to understand, I don't offer premarital counseling. I offer premarital coaching. And there's a very different. For you see, with premarital counseling, I'm the expert on marriage because the counselor is the expert and he or she gets to tell the client what to do. This is the way you do marriage. This is the way you do communication. This is the way you relate to each other. Okay, I'm no expert on marriage. You can ask my wife. I think I know what works in my marriage, but for me to tell these couples who come to me and say, can you counsel us? No, I can't. But I can ask you the questions because you know yourself better, and I can ask those questions to pull out of you what's going to work for you and your spouse to be. And typically when I meet with couples, we do coach over three main issues: communication, money, and intimacy. If couples can't get those three right, it's going to be a long, hard road. Communication, if you can't talk to each other, however you talk to each other, whether it's face-to-face, on the phone, or even by text, it doesn't matter how you talk as long as you communicate. Money has been the downfall of so many weddings. I've got my stash, you have your stash. Are we going to put our stashes together? Are we going to keep them separate? We're going to have joint credit cards, separate credit cards, joint checking account? Honestly, when they come to me and ask me that question, I don't care. It's not my money. But you all can figure that out because you know how best you're going to manage your money. And then intimacy, both physical, spiritual, and emotional. How are you going to live and communicate and be with the other? What works for one couple is not going to work for another couple. And so for me to say, this is how to do it, it doesn't work. So it's more of a coach approach, which works for couples. Because I could tell them what works for me and Kristen, but then they would look back at me and say, really? That works for you guys? Well, that would never work for us. Exactly. I'm not the expert on counseling, but hopefully I can coach them to get to where they want to be as a married couple. This morning, we're challenged with some other core issues on how to live as Christians, as faithful people of Christ, kind of like the communication, the money, and the intimacy that couples come to talk to me about. And I love the way Anna read the passage this morning. It was almost an exasperated, and I don't think that was intentional, Anna, but it was almost like an exasperated, you've got to be kidding me list. But I say to you who are listening, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who mistreat you. If anyone strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also. And from anyone who takes away your coat, do not withhold even your shirt. Give to everyone who asks of you, and if anyone takes away what is yours, do not ask for it back again. Do to others as you would have them do to you. Whew. That is a lot of core beliefs, core values that we have been given by Jesus of how we're supposed to live. And so after reading that list, I wonder, do we want the Jesus living counseling approach, or do we want the Jesus living coach approach to this? For if it's the counseling approach that we have, it is very clear. It is black and white. Love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. It is one way or the other. Jesus the expert, Jesus tells us exactly what to do. How many of us can say that we are in the process, that we love our enemies? However, I wonder, though, if we did take a coach approach to it. We took a coach approach because when we think about who Jesus was, we think about who we are. We think about how Jesus tells us to live, and we think about where we actually live and how we live. Which approach would be the best? I'm going to ask you to fill yourself in with this list, because I'm going to use myself as the example. But when we step back and think about Jesus and me or you, it gets a little muddy. You see, Jesus was the Son of God. I'm the son of Charles. Jesus was born in Bethlehem. I was born in Knoxville, Tennessee. Jesus is from Nazareth. I'm from Asheville, North Carolina. When Jesus was 12 years old, he spoke to the elders in the temple. When I was 12 years old, I was playing Little League baseball. The Bible is silent about Jesus from the ages of 12 to 30, for those 18 years. I can pretty much recall most everything I did between the ages of 12 to 30. Between the ages of 30 to 33, Jesus was out doing his ministry, performing miracles and healing people and preaching and teaching and doing all kinds of things. Between the ages of 30 and 33, I got married, I was in seminary, I had two children, and I started my first ministry job. Okay, I'm sorry, my life and Jesus' life, we're pretty much different. Yet Jesus tells us that we're supposed to do all of this exactly how it's prescribed. That's hard stuff. It's hard stuff because when you think about Jesus, he was perfect. He was without sin. He was God's son. When I look in the mirror, I see far from perfect. I see a lot of sin. I see someone who not only didn't walk in Jesus' shoes, I'm not even worthy to tie the thongs on his sandals. And so we're in this conundrum of, we've got this list, we're told what to do. How in the world are we going to get there to do it? I think that if we are serious about following Christ and living in this way and doing all these things, we have to find that one thing that really ties it all together. And if you read this list closely, it does end in a really good place, but it all leads with love. If we can embrace this idea of love, all of this other stuff falls into place. It falls into line like dominoes falling down. So we have to choose if we want to do this thing called love. And I'll be honest, love can be used so much that it loses that good, hard meaning. You're on the phone with a friend from college and say, you see your spouse getting ready to go to the grocery store, have a good trip down to Harris Teeter, love you. You talk to your child across the country in college, okay, sweetie, good luck on your test Monday, love you. Sometimes we throw that word around almost like we have to. But the love that Jesus wants us to have to live in this way is that deep love where we are very intentional about doing and living in the way of Christ. But let's be honest, the way I love and the way I try to do this is not going to be the way you do it. And the way you do it is not going to be the way you do it. Because I'm the expert on how I know how to love. You're the expert on how you know how to love. And you're the expert on how you know how to love. And so if we do choose love and we try our best, even if we fail and fall, we fall forward and we're still making progress on how to do it. It's kind of like me asking you all, at the end of worship today, everybody's invited, I want you to be there. Well, you can immediately choose one of two things. A, I'm going to go meet with Woody for lunch, it sounds like fun, or B, I'm not going to do it at all. Let's just say that we all do the right thing. You want to have lunch with me. So we're all going to go to Shem Creek. How are you going to get there? Are you going to drive? Are you going to drive your own car? Are you going to ride with somebody and carpool? Are you going to take the boat because you can get to Shem Creek by boat? Are you going to take an Uber? Are you going to take a Lyft? Are you going to walk? All of those are options. All of those are possibilities, and there is no one right way to get to Shem Creek, to Red's, to have lunch with me. In the same way, there are many different ways that we figure out how we love in the way that Jesus wants us to love. Because it's very difficult to do what Jesus says when we each have our own story and we each imprint who we are into this scripture. Jesus says, love your enemies. Am I really supposed to love? And how am I supposed to love someone who is physically and verbally abusive to me, to the point that I am in counseling and I have been to the ER over this? Jesus says I'm supposed to bless those who curse me. How am I going to bless someone who keeps yelling and cursing at me so much that I am so physically and emotionally tired that I can't get out of bed? Jesus says that I'm supposed to turn the other cheek after I've been struck on one. How am I supposed to turn my other cheek when I am scared to death anytime the other person moves, much less lifts a finger? We try because Christ calls us to love. But the way I do it is different than the way you do it. And that's an important part of the process. Jesus tells us at the very end of this passage, do to others as you would have them do unto you. Hopefully, we're doing that already. Hopefully, we are living in a way that we aren't the enemy, that we aren't those whose words are cursing. Hopefully, that we're not the ones who are striking and hitting. Hopefully, we're not the ones who are abusing. Hopefully, we're not the ones who are taking all the time. Hopefully we are those who are living with love and grace, and so that wherever we go, whenever we see others, they see that love through us, which comes from God. Sometimes it's hard because we do interact with other people. This passage is so easy to read inside these walls, inside this safe sanctuary. And we gather around these words and we say, oh yes, Jesus, yes. And then we go out into the world where we're hit, where we're struck, where we're yelled at, and where we're abused, and where we are called to love. I don't know what's going to work for you. You know what's going to work for you. But if we all claim that core value of loving, we're going to figure out a way to get there. It might not be today. It might not be tomorrow. It might not be in the car or the Uber or the boat to get to Red's. It might not all be at the same time. But as long as we commit ourselves to trying our very best every day, we're each going to get there. My path will be different than your path. Will be different than your path, will be different than your path. But when we say, yes, Lord, I want to love, I want to treat others the way I want to be treated, we will get there. And may we do our best to get there. Because it's not only about us, it's not only about the other, for it's about God's kingdom. And may we live in love in the kingdom of God. Amen.
Amen.
You are the people of God, having given your best to the Lord today through prayer, through song, and through word. May we all go from this place and be doers of the word and not hearers only. Go with God's love, go with God's grace, and go with God's peace.